Since the dawn of civilization, man has gazed in awe at the wondrous sights of the world. As today's technology blows away the sands of time, we are digging deeper into the secrets of these mysteries. The truths that we are uncovering, far from telling us of their human origins, increasingly point to the stars. Yet these wonders of extraterrestrial intelligence are not confined to our ancient history. In the past few decades, unexplained designs have been appearing in locations worldwide. What are these signs? Who made them? But most importantly of all, what are they trying to tell us? It was on the night of August the 12th, 1972, near Warminster, England, that two men named Bryce Bond and Arthur Shuttlewood witnessed the formation of what was to become known as a crop circle. Bryce and Shuttlewood left a chilling description of their sighting of the mysterious shape that seemed to appear from nowhere in the crop fields. Suddenly I heard a noise. It seemed that something was moving in the wheat field, flattening the stalks. That night the air was completely still. I looked around. The moon had just risen and was shining brightly. In front of me, I could see now a large, hollow depression in the middle of the crop field.
The more you look into this phenomenon, the more you find there's levels to it that just cannot be easily explained away.
Is it manifestations of our own subconscious? Is it parallel worlds? I mean, it's really rather humbling in a way. That you realise the more you investigate, the less you know, and really before you started this, you think, well, I probably knew nothing at all.
Whether it's in the mind, or it's something physical and tangible in the crop circle, you can't dispute that the actual crop circle event has actually had a profound effect on people.
Somewhere along the line, somebody's in control of this. It has to be an outside source. No physical technology in our society today is just wandering around the fields creating these things.
Well, it was one morning I went down, I think it was Sunday morning, I went down in the field to see how the crop was ripening, to see if it was fit to combine, and I looked up over the top of the crop and I could see some flattening, about three or four rings, different sizes. One circle was in within another one, and then it went smaller, and then there was like a big band round the small circle.
I don't know why me, but I seem to have had more than anybody else. I certainly don't encourage people or anything, and having seen so many, I know a genuine one from a poorly hoaxed one. There's too many of these crop circles that have appeared, you know, genuine ones that no one really has claimed to know how they got there.
Reports of crop circles are not a modern phenomenon. An English woodcut dated 1678 depicts the devil mowing a circle in the corn.
At the most famous old crop circle, which certainly looks like it was a crop circle, is the famous mowing devil illustration, which came out in a pamphlet which was issued in Hertfordshire in England in 1678, and it told the story of this farmer who'd had these strange circles appearing on his land. But what the picture shows and what, you know, is described in this report is so close to what we would today recognise as at least a basic crop circle, there's little doubt in some people's minds that they were dealing with the same thing back then.
In another remarkable instance, Robert Plott, a professor at Oxford University, England, in 1686, was to not only refer to a crop circle, but to offer a series of theories as to the cause of its formation. These explanations ran from rutting deer or rampant cattle to the presence of fairies, which may indeed occasion such circles. It was not until the early 1970s that archive files in England were thoroughly researched as public and scientific interest in crop circles grew. This led to the discovery of a dozen reports, from as early as the 1940s, which mentioned the sightings of small, flattened zones in crops. It took another 30 years for the circle phenomenon to be recognized, and a further 10 years for serious studies to begin.
I mean, there's around 300 documented reports sort of pre-1980 of crop circles, and there is no doubt this is not just a modern phenomenon. It's something that has been going on for a very, very long time. But for some reason, in around, you know, the 1970s, there was an increase in number and the complexity began to evolve.
Up until 1990, there had been few crop circles, but very plain, simple ones. But then in 1990, July the 2nd, I think it was, we had this shape appear in our fields, and no one knew what it was. And so it was a bit of a shock, a bit of a mystery. But I mean, that's where it all started for me anyway. We had the very first pictogram.
Far from being simple circles, these pictographs now depict complex mathematical curves, religious symbols, both modern and ancient, and a variety of animals. It is not only the shape of the circles that has changed over the years, it is also the size. Some circles now cover up to a massive 700 meters, and the largest recorded pictograph has been measured at an incredible 4,000 meters. Crop circles are generally formed in the summer nights between the hours of 2 to 4 a.m. Traditionally, the shortest evenings of the English year, when darkness lasts for only 4 hours. The amazing patterns often appear in fields that are closely watched by farmers, military, scientists, and enthusiastic members of the public who huddle in sleeping bags hoping to be lucky enough to see a crop circle forming.
I think the questioning about crop circles really starts with the circumstances under which they appear, because there's been many formations over the years which we know have appeared within very short periods of time.
Now, Milk Hill last year was a perfect example of that. You're talking 420 circles making up a design that's over 1,500 feet across in an evening which only had 4 hours of darkness. And I spoke to the farmer and he said he was there at dusk, and he was there at dawn. Dusk it wasn't there, dawn it was.
I mean, it was absolutely massive, and the field was undulating. It appeared on a day, well, during the night, when there was low cloud sitting on top of the hill and was drizzling, and it took up most of the field, and from the air it's absolutely perfect. And then when you're down on the ground and look at it, you just can't work out how anyone could have done that from the ground. I mean, it would have taken an army of people to do. And bearing in mind that the croppies, as I call them, who are the real enthusiasts who spend most of their summer camped out on our hills looking for, hoping to see something happen. I mean, they all appear and none of them get detected. No one's ever seen, no one's ever heard. They don't use light, they don't talk to each other. So it is people or persons doing it. I don't know how they do it.
For all the public fascination and scientific interest in crop circles, the question, who created them, remains unanswered. While the explanations of fairies and devils may have satisfied those in the 17th century, modern man is naturally more skeptical. But were the claims of our ancestors as ridiculous as they might seem? And is it possible that the creature depicted in the 17th century woodcut was not supernatural, but extraterrestrial? The very idea that crop circles are created by alien life forms excites great debate, and yet the arguments in favor of alien intervention contain the most compelling evidence. There are many recorded cases of strange things occurring in or near crop circles, from strange balls of light floating around the field to energy anomalies that defy explanation.
There's definitely a correlation between people, from reports I get, people will report seeing UFOs. Well, that's not to say the UFOs have actually, you know, created the crop circle. They may just be interested like we are. Or crop circles happen to appear in an area where UFOs are more likely to appear.
Well, let's say it is an alien outside force or something, and people witness it. Who's going to, you know, if someone comes up to you and said, oh, I just seen some aliens make a crop circle, you're not going to believe them anyway.
Now, as soon as you say the word UFO, you've got this whole connotation, and if you like, the baggage that comes with the idea of grey aliens, little green men, or abductions and all this. Now, I'm not saying there's nothing to that, because many people believe that there is, but separating out what might be, shall we say, a more universal intelligence creating these shapes or a being on a craft is something that is quite difficult. It's much hotly debated that if it's an intelligence, what kind of intelligence is it?
That's what we're going to look at now.
Dr. John Sherwood has been in contact with an extraterrestrial intelligence since an early age.
I've sort of had communication with Zarn ever since I was 4 years of age, and I've seen some pretty amazing stuff. Zarn basically was identified by Brian Crowley, who'd studied ancient Egyptian and Hebrew Sanskrits for about 38 years. He identified him as the Light Brotherhood. Now, the Brotherhood is like a council, alien council, call them what you like, and they help to maintain order in a very chaotic universe. And Zarn is part of them, but he has a high office as far as the tone and helix energies are concerned. He's pretty high up in the scheme of things. And he's sort of brought through an immense amount of knowledge, and I won't underestimate the powers that he has, because I've seen some remarkable stuff, and so have a lot of other people. This year he's going to be experimenting with the crop patterns in a way that's never been done before.
Do you actually find that you can actually take some of the crop circle shapes and you can plot them on a computer, convert them into sort of three-dimensional shapes or higher-dimensional mathematical shapes, revolve them in 3D space, and you'll actually get other crop circles, which then led me to believe that perhaps there's some interaction with, on a quantum physics level, on a parallel dimensions or some sort of dimension that we can't see.
When you're walking in there, you sort of get the impression of what's happened before you even get near it. You can feel the effect. It's almost like every geometric shape has an influence. And when you're talking about crop circles in specific, each one is unique within itself. Even if you get a pattern that appeared 4 years ago that looks like the one you've got now, the dynamics would still be different because the shape is different. It's in a different location. No two shapes are exactly the same.
If the true language of the universe is geometry, as those who seek the truth about the crop circles are convinced, it appears that somebody, somewhere, has been calling to us for generations. The message is related to us not by voice, but in the form of mathematical shapes, angles, and scientific formulae.
Many people believe that this is the result of an alien intervention, that these patterns are an attempt to initiate communication in such a way as to not create panic. So the theory runs that instead of turning up in flying saucers hovering over our cities and scaring the living daylights out of everyone, that what an extraterrestrial intelligence might do instead is slowly create little patterns that slowly they get people's attention.
If you're going to talk with children at kindergarten level relative to knowledge, you have to start with the basics and bring it up. If humanity has gone backwards in its understanding of natural laws and physics, then we have to be turned around. And the easiest way is to subtly introduce us to different aspects of geometry, science, in such a way that it slowly starts to turn our consciousness around in a direction where we can only learn from what we do rather than not learn from what we do. A crop circle will do that. It will raise questions in your own mind. 9 times out of 10, you'll find your own answers.
In England, during the summer of 1991, more and more complex formations appeared. On the 17th of July, a crop circle appeared near an Iron Age hill fort, known as Barbary Castle, that represented a triangle with a circle on each point. Within, and overlapping the triangle, were two circles with a third circle in the center, with three points reaching out to connect the three circles at the end of each triangular tip. A magnificent creation, the Barbary Castle tetrahedron is believed by enthusiasts to be an alchemical design that represented a warning to us of the dangers of modern life.
Humanity is going through, for want of a better phrase, a lot of spiritual evolving at the moment. We're having these many religious conflicts going on, spiritual beliefs and so forth. We've gone through a lot over the last 50 years. Since the end of the Second World War, there's been a massive technologically advanced leap forward, computerized technology and all these other things taking place. And all of a sudden, our own ability to understand our spiritual existence has sort of been pushed a bit to the back. So we've suddenly lost our ability to see where we're going and how to get there and what the influences are that make us make these decisions to make that step forward. And the entire purpose behind them, from what I can tell at this point, is to develop our abilities so that we understand our thought processes more and recognize that what we think is what we are. And that's what a crop design does. You stand in it, you immediately think about you, about yourself, because what's it doing? It's making you focus on your feelings. What do you feel when you walk into a crop field? People walk up to me and say, I've never been in these before, but wow, you know, the sensations I'm getting. Now, how long has it been since they were aware of those sensations, of their interaction between themselves and their environment? An immense amount of time.
The most significant message left for us was discovered on the 18th of August 1991 at Foxfield, southern England. Later referred to as the Serpent, the formation was indeed snake-like in its appearance. The most astounding physical attribute of this incredible pictograph was that parts of the pattern would stop dramatically, only to start again without any sign of interruption between the patterns. If the serpent is impressive physically, scientifically it is astounding. It very clearly depicts a human DNA chromosome that has suffered ultraviolet damage. Those that subscribe to the theory that crop circles are extraterrestrial messages offer no further proof that this fabulously detailed formation is a warning against destroying our ozone layer.
There's many things about crop circles that you have to look at, because the first thing people see is the beautiful pattern. And for many people, that's where it stops. But for those people who then go into the field and then begin to look at the way it's constructed, you can often find some very interesting things.
You actually find, if you look around the edge of the crop circle, where it's well-defined sort of pastry cutter edge, you can almost find single strands that have almost been sucked in from the outside. And I've actually found single stalks that have come into the formation under the lay, which obviously couldn't have happened through just stomping it. And also, we've found a couple of occasions I've been called out to a crop circle where you could see the circle in the field. The actual circle, instead of being flattened to the ground, the circle's formed by the actual seed heads being about 2 inches lower than the rest of the crop, because there's a sort of double kink in the stem, so it goes up, it's bent out and then bent back.
And there have been many cases over the years where you can find sort of different levels. You will find one level of flat crop underneath another. So when you begin to look down there with your hands and knees, you can often find interesting things that raise questions that don't appear to have easy answers to them.
Crop circles are not only beautiful and intricate pieces of art, they are also scientific oddities. For not only does the appearance of the corn change, so too does its biological structure. The outside of the plant stalks, called the epidermal wall, is lengthened, and the joints that are made as the plant grows, called the nodes, which naturally tilt to one side, dramatically stretch and bend.
Now, it is not possible to bend a node. If you try to bend a stem, it will bend either side of a node, and yet we find very swollen and elongated nodes bent at peculiar angles, often to make an actual circle itself. And I saw a fine example of that a few years ago, where had this crop, you know, one swathe of crop not actually been curved, there would have been no circle. So this is where you begin to see, well, that clearly was not done by somebody crunching this down with a plank of wood.
Well, there are a number of patterns that actually I can go back to and think about that actually had their stalks bent 6 inches from the ground. So you're talking about that much stalk, and then it curves over like that. Whereas this piece is straight from the ground up, and then you get that, bah, goes over like this. I mean, there have been tops of trees that have gone over. These are full-grown trees. The top 30 feet was over like this with a crop formation on the top of the forest. Rice paddies, same thing. 22,000 gallons of water disappears in a rice paddy in Japan in a matter of about, you know, a couple of minutes. And in the centre of the rice field is this crop field, crop pan.
Within the plant, the matter that eventually grows into seeds becomes disfigured and warped, while holes are formed inside the stalk itself as if they had been heated up from the inside.
The scientists who've come and taken plant tissues, you know, say the molecular structure of the leaf is definitely altered. And on some occasions, some of our seeds have been microwaved, which means, you know, they've been heated from the inside out.
And what's so interesting is that you find that the embryonic seed heads have been mutated when compared to samples taken from just a few inches outside of the formation. There's things like the cells have almost been swollen, elongated, or almost as if the moisture inside them has popped out, maybe due to heat.
Crop circles also appear to subtly change the electrical and magnetic forces of the area in which they are formed, an effect confirmed and witnessed by scientists and laymen alike. There is often an increase in infrared output within and around a new formation. Sometimes the soil in and around them seems to have been baked. Crop circles appear to have the capacity to alter the local electromagnetic field so that compasses cannot locate north. In some instances, cameras, cell phones, and batteries fail to operate, and aircraft equipment fails while flying over them. Levels of background radiation rise up to 300% above normal, and radio frequencies fall dramatically or rise sharply within the perimeters of the circle. In one eerie instance, the car batteries in three entire villages failed to operate the morning after a circle was discovered nearby. Sometimes, entire towns have been left without power.
I've had experience with doing filming inside circles when we couldn't get any of the equipment to work. You know, odd things happen, and cameramen, experienced cameramen who've been all around the world, you know, said to me, Jesus, that, you know, that's never happened before. That's weird, you know, and that's experienced people.
I think the biggest impact I've had in a crop pan to date was standing in a crop field in the middle of a design, and there was absolutely zero sound. You couldn't hear anything outside of the design. And as soon as you stood outside of the design, you could hear the birds, you could hear the animals, other sounds, jets going overhead, helicopters in the distance. But you step back in, it disappears. That was the most unique one I think I've stood in.
Right, I've got a number of bits and pieces in here. This is the original gadget that got me involved in the first place, which is basically a very sensitive electrostatic meter. And basically, when I found, sort of in the early years as it were, you'd go into the crop circle, if you touch it on the corn outside, you'll get a sort of reading like that. You get to the crop circle and it will stop. So you get the, you know, you continue on the other side of the crop circle, it'll start again. If this one suddenly does indicate you know, something interesting or anomalous, I've then actually got some commercial equipment here. First one is this little thing here, which is probably commonly known as a bug detector, or technically known as a RF sniffer. It will basically act to detect any form of radio signal. So you'll find here we're getting round about sort of 500 megahertz, just as the background RF count. And what happens is, because as you can see here, it's fluctuating a fair bit anyway, sort of plus or minus 50. When I actually go into a crop circle, some crop circles, it will suddenly go up 200% or 300%. So whereas it was reading 100 megahertz outside, you'll go into the formation, it will jump up to 300 megahertz or 400 megahertz. And I've even had times when one formation, it was about 75 megahertz outside. In the formation, it suddenly jumped up to about 650.
Now, I had a crazy situation last year where I had a GPS satellite positioning unit in my hand, and I walked into a crop field and I was getting the usual satellite positions, but I had one extra. I had one coming from the center of the pattern, and I thought, this isn't right. Why am I getting this reading coming from the middle of this particular crop pattern? And no matter where I placed myself in the pattern, this thing changed position on the reader. So if I went up there, it would come over here. If I went down here, it would go up there. So I knew it was, no matter where I went, it always pointed to the center of this particular circle.
There is a view that there are such things as called earth energies, that there is this natural grid of invisible energy fields which surround the planet, and that they take certain shapes in certain areas. Now, some people have pointed out, like people who douse with pendulums and rods, have said that many crop circles, that they appear in connection with the actual shapes of the natural energy fields, and that these play a part. And there is some possibility that that could be true, because we talk about the geological connection, underground water. Underground water and quartz, for instance, are known to produce piezoelectric fields, which may well be the kind of thing that the dowsers are picking up, and it may well be that they play some role in the formation of these shapes.
The theory that circles somehow affect electromagnetic charges and the magnetic points on a compass became the subject of further debate on August the 12th, 1989, with the discovery of the spectacular swastika at Winterbourne Stoke in England. Here was an amazing new level in the intricacies of crop circles, a formation that saw the crop bent in four quadratures, exactly aligned to the magnetic compass points. At the center, the crop rotated and counter-rotated in three movements. At the boundary edge, another thin band rotated clockwise, with crop weaving over and under the central quadratures. Any human hoax here was surely out of the question. Nothing on Earth could have produced the swastika. In 1996, a pilot flew over Stonehenge, the incredible and imposing ancient monument that has stood on Salisbury Plain in Wiltshire, England, for thousands of years. The pilot saw nothing as he flew above the monument, yet 15 minutes later, a huge 900-foot formation, comprising 149 meticulously laid circles, was laid opposite the stone circle, on the opposite side of the A303 trunk road. When the seriologists, the new name given to those who study crop circles, arrived to examine the formation, it took a team of 11 researchers over 5 hours just to survey the pictograph. Reports then came in of strange medical phenomena taking place after people had been walking around the pattern.
Over the years, many people have noticed that when you go inside crop circles, that your health can be affected, or that when you walk in them, you can physically feel almost like a sort of an electric charge. Now, some people react very positively to this. Other people go very negative, and there's been many reports of good effects, tales of miracle cures taking place inside crop circles. On the other hand, other people have been very ill and had very bad effects. So when you start to look at this, you have to say that there's something emanating from these shapes or being focused in there. It's not just flattened crop. That these shapes in themselves either attract or generate something which you can feel when you go inside them. You are, you know, physically feeling the effects of this earth energy being focused by this very specific pattern, which in itself may be a reflection of the energy patterns which are in the ground.
There was one woman I remember who couldn't get into the circle. Something was physically, you know, repelling her. Other people would go in there and feel nauseous. Some people were sick. Other people said their watches stopped, their cameras didn't work. You know, all these things. Now, whether they're all psychological or not, I don't know. And, you know, maybe you want to feel something when you go into these things.
If you think about it, people have gone into crop patterns. Women have gone in after the menopause, and they've suddenly started getting their cycles again. And then other people have gone in with aching hips, come out, hips have been fine. Other people, broken bones, 7 days later it's healed. Or there's a whole array of different effects. Other people have gone into patterns and felt nauseous, totally sick. You've got to understand, geometric shape can affect human form.
Lucy Pringle studies the various medical effects that crop circles appear to produce.
Sometimes you get a very, very strange metallic taste in your mouth when you go into a genuine crop circle, and you can't get it out, you can't spit it out, you can't rinse it out, it's totally cloying, it's there. You can have intense nausea, I mean real severe nausea, so you think you're going to upchuck, and you have to go down a tram line, and literally, after a short time, you're fine. Then you get the mind, the mental part, and this I suppose is the biggest category, where you get your thought processes affected. Long-term memory loss, feelings of euphoria. A friend of mine who's had a really traumatic life, she's got Parkinson's. And when you've got Parkinson's, you shake so many times per second. It's a devastatingly, physically depleting condition. And she tried every avenue of orthodox medicine and eventually said, oh, well, Lucy's always banging on about crop circles. She said, I'm going to try one out this year. And so she and a friend went in to this one and they sat in the center just for 20 minutes and she didn't shake once for 24 hours. Now, if we could measure those frequencies which she experienced, which affected the area of her brain, which prevented her shaking, we would have a cure for Parkinson's.
Although crop circles are a worldwide phenomenon, nearly 80% of the global total have appeared in the UK, and 75% of these have been found in a small area of central southern England. Within this area are some of the world's greatest archaeological treasures, including Avebury, Silbury Hill, and of course Stonehenge.
You do get crop circles all around the world. But for some reason, the centre of it does seem to be here in England and in this particular area around Avebury in Wiltshire. And if you look over the years, you will find that, you know, the vast majority of England's really big patterns have appeared within a 30-mile radius of Avebury. There are many reasons that have been put forward for this. I think the best reason, which appears to explain it, is geology. Because when you look at the geological maps of southern England and you compare charts which show you where the underground water is, what's known as the aquifers, you realise that these are also exactly the areas where we've had the vast majority of crop circles. They seem to appear in areas of underground water, and this geological connection quite possibly explains just why certain areas get many more formations than others. Everything has to have its centre, and maybe it just so happens, due to geological reasons and maybe other factors as well, that this is the centre. It could have been Paraguay, it could have been in Portugal, but it's here, and those of us living in England are lucky enough to be near the centre of it.
With its links to the mysterious peoples of antiquity, is it possible that the Neolithic civilizations which settled in the region saw crop circles as a message from the gods?
The actual crop patterns themselves have been appearing on and off for about 70,000 years. The thing you have to be aware of is that when you see things like devil markings tromping a pattern down in a wheat field, you're dealing with the mentality of the day. So, when we see these particular simple designs being laid down, we also have to understand how ancient monuments can be built over these ancient sites, because anything that appears in a natural way like that has to have some sort of sacred link associated with it. In other words, it's a sign from the gods. So, what do you do? Well, we've got to commemorate the site. Let's build something.
Did the people who built Avebury witness, or, you know, woke up one morning and saw this huge inner and outer circle, you know, in the long grass, which it would have been, you know, during summer, and to commemorate it, because in those days they would worship anything, you know, the sun, whatever freaked them out, they'd worship, because they, you know, they were frightened. And, you know, there's nothing to say that they didn't place stones around these two, you know, two circles.
Stonehenge is the most spectacular Bronze Age site in the whole of Europe. The first stones were laid in about 3200 BC, and it was not completed until around 1300 BC. To this day, Stonehenge remains shrouded in mystery. Was it used in Druid ceremonies or to observe the sun, the moon, and the stars? It is incredible to think that the stones from which it is constructed were transported from the mountains of southern Wales, a distance of some 400 kilometres.
It's a phenomenal amount of distance to take stones just to build something this simple. But when you look at what it actually does, the piezoelectrical field that is energised around Stonehenge from the crystal and quartz deposits in both the Sarsen stones and the Blue stones is immense. But only immense at certain times, in certain years, on a certain day. And when you know how to use that, you get some dramatic effects from it.
Visitors to Stonehenge are awed by its size. 17 enormous Sarsen rock pillars, each 13.5 feet tall, supporting 6 curved stone lintels, are all that survive of the original unbroken circle of 30 lintels over 30 uprights. In its original form, Stonehenge was one of the most exact and symmetrical works ever created. Each lintel was curved on its inner and outer sides to form arcs of 2 circles whose radii differ by a lintel's width. Jointed together by tongue and groove joints usually employed by woodworkers, the lintels are connected to the uprights by holes cut into their underside to receive projecting tenons. This same building principle can be found in Egypt and other ancient sites.
There are immense links both to places like Machu Picchu in Peru, the Great Pyramids of Egypt, Palenque, a lot of the Mayan, Inca, Aztec buildings. You find methodologies and architectural designs and structures that are so similar. It's almost like they were all sitting in the same room learning from the same person, because it's there.
Fifteen miles to the north of Stonehenge are the prehistoric sites of Avebury and its neighbouring site, Silbury Hill. The stones from Avebury have been ravaged throughout the centuries to provide building materials for the surrounding village. But many stones remain, and markers now indicate where missing stones once stood. The original formation stretched across the hills like a serpent, its head resting on Overton Hill, which has often been likened to the serpent in Egyptian mythology. The avenue, which runs from the side of the Avebury Ring, runs in a specific direction that would eventually arrive directly at the Great Pyramids of ancient Egypt.
I find Avebury very interesting because it's a sequence of a circle with 2 smaller circles on the inside. So when you look at that, we immediately see totality with balance. The two circles inside a circle regarding ancient mythology and symbolism represents balance. Now, that in association with the country means totality of balance in harmony, whether it be heart, whether it be soul, whatever. That is where the totality is. It's nowhere else. That's how simple things can be. We make things complex because we think they have to be. But they're not. I mean, if you walk into any crop pattern with an open mind, you get a feedback. If you walk into any ancient site with an open mind, you get a feedback. You've got to allow it to happen. People fight themselves, little realizing that when they're fighting themselves, they're fighting everything else as well. Don't. Just let nature take its course and you'll learn a lot more.
Again, ancient man went along much more with his feelings, and Avebury is just on a mass of these energy lines, ley lines, as we call them, which the people with their dowsing rods are able to pick out. And Avebury is a massive crossroads of all these ley lines, as is Stonehenge. And all our, well, the majority of crop circles we've had, you know, people come with their dowsing rods and they all douse, so they're on energy lines.
Like Stonehenge, Avebury is reputed to have great healing and restorative powers. These powers are believed by some to have been tapped from the earth, with the stones working as a type of circuit breaker. Believers are certain that this formation can only have been created by those from another world who knew how to tap into the earth's natural power and left it to us as a gift. The formations at Silbury Hill and Avebury have been linked not only to crop circles, but to an ancient complex many, many thousands of miles away. For Silbury Hill's internal dynamic shape is an exact replica of Saqqara, the Great Pyramid in Egypt.
Avebury has a number of aspects associated with it. The avenue, for example. If you stand at a certain point in the centre of the Avebury ring and you align the path up, you're pointing at the pyramids in Egypt. So there's a link there. You're talking about Silbury Hill. It's got the same dynamic internal construction technique as the Saqqara pyramid in Egypt. You go to Stonehenge, you're talking about massive lintels with caps. You're talking about the same type of structural technique, building-wise, architecture-wise, as the Valley Temple, Abydos. The whole concept is all of these ancient sites have a similar architectural footprint that could only have come from one source. You're talking about identifying the difference between a Rembrandt and a Picasso. If you're an art lover, you will know the difference. But it takes training, it takes understanding of the intricacies associated with each individual different item. So when you look at Stonehenge, you look at the design structure of that, you look at the Valley Temple, you look at Abydos, the structural techniques, they're identical. Then when you look at the architectural design of a crop field, and then you go over to Egypt and you look at hieroglyphic patterns in some of the ancient crypts, you're looking at the same thing. You're looking at a pictographic form that is a language within itself. Hieroglyphs are a language within themselves. Crop circles are no different. They are a language and a knowledge storehouse. There is so much that can be learned from them.
The question remains, what forces forged those links? Given that they were beyond human scope, can it have been the work of someone or something not of this world?
We go back 500,000 years to what we would classify as the progenitor of the human race. Alien in origin, designed humanity in a specific way to do a specific task. We're here for a purpose. The technology that makes us survive is the grid system that surrounds the planet. One of the reasons why the human body degenerates so much when astronauts go up into space is because they're beyond the energy field or the energy grid field that surrounds the planet. So the body starts to degenerate. If you artificially generate that same energy field around the spacecraft, there will be no degeneration of human life form whatsoever. The ability to maintain a constant without muscle degradation of any kind will remain static. In other words, you'll stay healthy.
The Great Pyramid is the largest human construction on the planet. It covers nearly 14 acres at its base and rises to a height of nearly 500 feet. It is composed of some 2,300,000 limestone blocks, each weighing from 2.5 to 10 tons, rising upwards at a precise angle of 51 degrees, 52 minutes. The exterior casing stones, now almost all removed, were at one time highly polished and covered the entire structure with a smooth, gleaming surface. The Grecian Herodotus tells us that the Great Pyramid of Khufu, also called Cheops, or simply the Great Pyramid, was built in just 20 years by teams of 100,000 men working in 3-month shifts. These were either loyal subjects of the pharaoh, or slaves, or more likely, a combination of both. This account supposes that the huge stones were quarried from a gigantic limestone formation nearby. Modern Egyptologists also hold that the quarried blocks were dragged or rolled over the sands to the Giza Plateau. The writings of Herodotus also suggest that some sort of huge leverage device was employed to raise the stones to each succeeding level. Here, Egyptology parts company with the great historian. Many modern theorists believe the structure was raised by virtue of an earthen ramp that was constructed as the pyramid rose and was then dismantled from the top down, allowing workers to put the casing stones in place as the ramps receded. The stones were shaped to such fine tolerance that a knife blade could not be inserted between them. It is difficult to comprehend a work of such optical precision being completed by humans on this scale so long ago. How were the huge stone blocks used to build the pyramid, weighing from 2.5 to 10 tons, quarried, transported over the sand, and raised to a height of nearly 50 stories?
The easiest way to explain this is to go back to some ancient stories. The ancient priests had staffs made of specific types of metal, and to move stones down rods, they would lay sheets of metal down made of another type of metal. Put the stone on there, take the staff, strike the metal, the stone would float, and they push it with the finger. But when you look at the construction techniques and the hermetic seals associated with the stones, to cut something that flat, there isn't a saw blade today that could get it that flat. So there's only one solution for the way this can be so flat. And that is using harmonic resonance to molecularly alter the surface of the stone so that it turns to liquid and gravity does the rest. When it's flat on its surface and it's gravity orientated, the surface will become what we call zero absolute flat. Then it just rehardens and it stays that way. Then you turn it into a perpendicular position, put another one next to it with the water surface on the top, the hermetic seal drags them together, and that becomes a permanent seal. Just because the scientific principle of harmonic energy transmission is beyond our understanding of physical science at this point in time doesn't mean to say it doesn't exist. I mean, I remember before we got Hubble, scientists had this theory and astronomers had this theory that things only went so far, and that when they targeted Hubble at a black area of space, they didn't expect to see anything. What did they find? Well, they found a whole stack of different developed galaxies and systems. What I'm saying is, to be a scientist, a sincere one, you cannot hope to approach things like this with a closed mind. You have to approach it with an open mind and say, okay, what are the possibilities? Let's explore that. Any decent researcher will go into things with an open mind and say, okay, how did that 20-ton block of granite get 400 feet in the air?
Strangely enough, it was not a scientist, but a soldier who first saw the need to decode the language of the pyramids. Some 2,000 years after Herodotus made his journey to the Nile Delta, the Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, with his small army of scholars, scientists, artists, and mathematicians, stood before the awesome structures and asked the same questions. How were they built and why? How long did it take? It was Napoleon's army of servants that began what has since become a science in itself. Napoleon's scholars set about measuring, calculating, and theorizing about the pyramids. But why are we left to theorize? It is incredible to think that although the ancient Egyptians were prolific record keepers, no mention is made anywhere in Egyptian writings of the Great Pyramids. There is not a word about who or when or why they were built.
They were probably one of the best record keepers around, yet there is no hieroglyphic evidence to show that the pyramids were built by the pharaohs. Pyramids and the Sphinx belong together, yes, because they were both built, all built at the same time. The whole complex was built in the same time frame. Now, the Egyptians are the first ones to accept that if anything is discovered that shows that their ancestry predates the pharaohs, hey, they're quite happy to accept that. Because it shows that their culture is far older than originally estimated.
Today, scientists put computers and calculators to work and still cannot solve the puzzle of the pyramids. Even though they continue to give up their treasures, the Great Pyramids continue to keep their secrets. No scientist, for example, has yet been able to explain the huge 75-ton granite spirit stones in the heart of the Great Pyramid at Giza. Why are they there? What is their purpose? And perhaps more importantly, how did they get there? While Egyptologists would have us believe that the pyramids were built as magnificent tombs for the pharaohs, the indisputable fact is that no mummy of any kind, no king, queen, or commoner, has ever been found in any pyramid. In the case of the Great Pyramid, there is no indication that anything even remotely resembling the funerary embellishments of the great pharaohs was ever there.
If we look at the internal structure of the pyramid, the dynamics of the geometry is also important. 51 degrees, 52 minutes is the angle of the side, right? When the internal angles of both the ascending and descending chamber are half that angle in ratio, you've got exact geometry with the ascending and descending relative to the apex to base. You've got three chambers inside the pyramid that we know of, kings, queens, and lower chamber. Each one has a specific use. You've got three, okay? We're in a three-dimensional space. So each one handles different energy. Now, these principles apply to crop circle patterns as well. They also apply to ancient sites. So what we're talking about now is the basic dynamic principle that dictates the structural techniques to create these places. So you've got these three different energies that make up a three-dimensional space. If you have the ability to calculate each individual energy principle, what you do then is you structure your shape relative to it. In other words, the height, width, and depth will create that type of energy within that space. So in other words, the king's chamber would have to be a specific size to meet the criteria for, say, type A. Let's put labels on the three-dimensional energy and say type A is A, type B is B, type C is C, etc. Just for simplicity reasons. So the king's chamber is type A, queen's is type B, lower chamber is type C. And the only way they would not be that way is if they were an inch out in either height, width, or depth.
The Great Pyramid contains enough stone to build 35 Empire State Buildings. In spite of its great size and bulk, the pyramid's alignment to true north is virtually perfect. To this day, the precision of that alignment has never been duplicated. The pyramid sits on a plot of desert that just happens to have a solid base of limestone underneath the sand. It weighs 700,000 tons, yet in 5,000 years, the Great Pyramid has settled less than one half inch. It is also situated on the prime meridian of Earth, its east-west, north-south axes intersecting the only lines of longitude and latitude in the world that equally divide the Earth's land masses and oceans. How could this all have been a monumental series of coincidences? The mysteries do not stop there. The pyramids were constructed at a time when mankind certainly believed the Earth to be flat. Yet in the design and the construction of the Great Pyramid, we are faced with the truth that whoever built the monument could calculate the longitude and latitude of the Earth as a sphere.
You've got Cheops, you've got Khafre, you've got Mykerinus. Each a different dynamic shape, each a different dynamic angle, each slightly different in design. Each one is not a flat surface. When the casing stones were on, they were concaved in like dishes on each side. They're not dead flat, they were curved. That's because each one was transmitting energies in four different directions, north, south, east, west. The pyramids themselves emit energy out into the atmosphere. Each one handles the individual energy structure. Now, in this case, mathematically, we call it type 3, type 6, and the integer series. Each individual sacred site was built as part of this system. Now, let's use a few facts. First of all, according to history, the casing stones of the pyramids were supposed to have been removed by the people of Cairo when they had the earthquake in the mid-1500s. Not the case. Forget it. It didn't happen. Because what they did is they did not remove the stones from the side of the pyramid. They weren't on the pyramid. They were scattered around the base. The casing stones had already been off. They'd been removed thousands of years ago. Reason? To make it inactive. The casing stones basically were like an enhancer. They were quartz. They had a quartz deposit built into them. Now, if you know anything about limestone, right, what happens if you heat limestone? It glows. It gives off its own energy. But it gives off its own energy in a light form. And if you hit limestone with a specific frequency, it will glow. And it radiates energy out. And that's what it used to do. It doesn't anymore. But it used to do that. Now, there's no way on God's green earth that can be reproduced in today's technology. So again, we're talking about advanced technology and science beyond where we are. So we're dealing with an alien intelligence that used to exist, is still around even today. And we need to get to understand it more.
It is not only in Africa that there are tantalizing glimpses and suggestions of extraterrestrial forces at work. In the Mayan civilization of South America, too, there is evidence that is difficult to ignore. The Temple of Inscriptions at Palenque in Mexico is the site of a secret tomb in which was discovered a sarcophagus. Discovered in 1952, the carvings on the lid of the sarcophagus show an unmistakable depiction of a man steering a skyrocket. The evidence continues to mount, but the answers to the questions remain stubbornly unanswered. How is it possible that crop circles formed in the 20th century, stone monuments built in ancient times, and pyramids built a world away share the same principles of mathematics and design? What is the missing link? And given the evidence before us, is it possible, just possible, that that link may be from another world? In the south of England, another summer rolls around, and once more the farmers' fields are filled with crops. But already the crop circles are there, defying all that modern technology can throw at them. Perhaps one day we will discover if these magical, mystical, and beautiful patterns really are signs from heaven.
When you start to put all this together, you realize there's no one easy answer. And I think the ultimate solution to this is going to be an amalgamation of all the different theories. but it won't be an obvious answer. We're all waiting for a flying saucer to come down and for someone to come out and say, it's done like this. But I don't think it's going to happen like that.